Good morning and welcome to today's meeting of the Senate Standing Committee on the Judiciary. Today I am joined by my colleague Senator Thomas O'Mara, the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee, as well as Senator Boyle, Senator Razenhofer, Senator Breslin, Senator Bailey, and Senator Thomas. Any opening comments, Senator O'Mara?
No, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. The first bill is Senate Print 1688 by Senator Montgomery.
An act to amend the real property law, the civil practice law and rules, and the criminal procedure law in relation to distressed home loans.
Do any senators have any comments or questions on the bill? Seeing none, is there a motion to move the bill?
Aye.
Senator Thomas makes that motion. Second. Senator Bailey seconds the motion. All those in favor of Senate Print 1688 by Senator Montgomery, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Without rec.
Without rec. From Senator Boyle and Senator O'Mara, the bill is reported to the floor. The second bill is Senate Print 1868 by Senator Bailey.
An act to amend the civil practice law and rules in relation to exempting parties liable for failure to obey or enforce certain orders of protection or temporary orders of protection in domestic violence or domestic relations matters from the provisions of Article 16 of such law entitled Limited Liability of Persons Jointly Liable.
Senator Bailey, any comments you'd like to make?
No, I just want to thank you for bringing this on to the agenda. Obviously, we won't have a call to protect victims of domestic violence, and any way that we can do that to make it easy in the courts for those victims is really appreciated. And Mr. Chair, thank you for bringing this to the committee.
Any other further comments or questions? Senator Razenhofer.
A further explanation of this bill in terms of what the law is right now and how this changes the law.
Sure.
Right, so currently the law is that the person would be liable for economic damages to 100%, whatever their responsibility is, but they would only be liable for non-economic damages up to the portion of their liability. So this would make them jointly and separately liable for both economic and non-economic damages, which would be returned to the Commonwealth.
So who would be the other entity other than the person who the order of protection is against?
It would be against anybody who fails to enforce the order of protection. So under current law, officers in certain situations are required to arrest a person who they have reasonable cause to believe has violated an order of protection. And so presumably they can be found liable for failure to arrest when legally required to do so.
So this would only apply to police agencies then?
Well, it also is for failure to obey, so the but it would also be the individual, but yes, the police.
No, I'm aware of obviously the person who who is the affected violation of the order of protection, but the other entity, would that only apply to police agencies and therefore the municipality?
Yes, I believe they're the only ones required to enforce the order of protection.
So is this only then for someone who fails to arrest, like a police agency?
It's not about arresting, it's about setting an expectation whether they would be liable for not enforcing an order. The standard right now in the Board of Appeals is very, very high. This particular provision doesn't change the standard of liability at all. It just said, which is a very high threshold, you have to actually somehow indicate to the victim that you're there to protect them and you're there 24 hours and somehow you sort of leave and the victim then gets, and the perpetrator comes and violates the order of protection. So you sort of induce the person to rely on that kind of 24/7 kind of protection. So the standard is not being changed here, which is a very high standard in the Court of Appeals. But what this is doing is saying that the victim themselves should not bear the full brunt of when there are people who are liable. They themselves should not be left holding the bag. That's all it's saying is that the apportioned liability, which now there are about 10 and 15 or so other exemptions, this is adding domestic violence survivors also to those exemptions.
No, I understand that this doesn't deal with the liability aspect, but obviously obviously I understand the, you know, the part about the police agency and therefore the municipality where someone doesn't enforce and presumably been notified. But what about, for instance, a you know, a school where a school is aware that there's an order of protection, they've been advised, and they don't, you know, they don't do whatever someone thinks that they should do. Are they now going to be on the hook for additional damages under this new?
Under this proposal, we do not believe that the school will be affected. No.
So is. Why wouldn't the school, are there any exemptions to, in reading the bill and the memo, I didn't see that there were any exclusions of the joint several liability. Like, it didn't say this doesn't apply to schools.
The school is not liable to enforce an order of protection, law enforcement is.
Okay. So there's no responsibility or no duty, no obligation on behalf of the school. If a school knows that there's an order of protection in place, say mother and father, and they know that the father is there and the mother is there, and they don't call the police, there's no responsibility at all on the part of the school for not calling. Is that what you're saying?
As far as I know, I don't think that a school has any obligation to enforce an order of protection.
Do they have any obligation to call a police entity to notify them?
I do not believe that they have any obligation under current law.
So on the bill, so you're talking about the damages section. So right now, the way the law is that it is only, there's only joint and several liability for economic damages. Is that correct?
Yes.
Right. Okay. So now what you're doing here is you're expanding that for pain and suffering. Is that correct?
Yes.
Do you know how many cases there are in the state of New York in any given year dealing with lawsuits by domestic violence victims against the actual violator and the other entity, whatever it may be, police agency, municipality? Do you know how many there are?
Are
we talking about a handful, dozens, hundreds?
We don't have that information. I presume there's not that many because the standard is so high, as I indicated, the liability threshold is very, very high. All this does is it says whenever there is a portion of liability in this case, in these situations, there will be 100% liability by people who are already found to be liable. Again,
I understand that. And this doesn't change anything with respect to business owners. A lot of these cases involve situations at hotels and places like that, that they're not affected at all.
No, I don't think it does touch it.
Do you mind just illuminating for us like an example of how this might work in terms of like a defendant who is not current under the status quo, the current status, a defendant is not held liable in what circumstance?
Well, the defendant would be held liable, but it's a question of who in fact is, and there is also liability by the municipality, again, if they're found liable, which is a very high threshold. If they were to be found liable, then all parties would be responsible for that particular.
Mm-hmm. But currently, just for our, the nature of the limited liability under the current law, what could you describe that?
Yeah, so the limited liability under the current law means that, for example, the a defendant who's found liable might have to pay 100% of the medical costs if there's an injury and a person has to go to the hospital, but they don't have to pay.
Can you just say that again? You say the defendant is not liable?
No, under the current law, the defendant would be liable for economic damages, so that might include the costs of a hospital stay if they need to be hospitalized or potentially missed work or something like that. But it wouldn't they wouldn't have to compensate the victim or the survivor for things like pain and suffering or trauma or things like that. So only things that you can prove an economic damage for.
Any other further comments or questions?
Yeah, I just want to clarify an extension to Senator Ranzenhofer's questions, and you mentioned liability of municipalities. Would this be opening up liability to our County Department of Social Services or the State Office of Children and Family Services for failure to act in these situations?
I don't believe that this would create state that kind, at least I don't, haven't seen any case law that would implicate them, because again, they're not responsible for enforcing a court order. They have independent requirements under Article 10 and other provisions of the social services law, that this should not impact that.
Any further questions or comments?
Just to be clear, there are other provisions in case law or statute that cover when there's certain orders that we have to enforce. They give people the right to sue already, so I don't think this is expanding anything.
Right. It's,
yeah, you can bring pain, suffering, a lot of different things. If you don't enforce a law, a lot of different things, but I don't think this is expanding anything.
According to the bill,
it's fine. Well, it's just a pain and suffering component, but you can, right. You can sue me in different legal theories and case law for basically the same thing. That's what I'm saying.
But the bill is expanding the law.
To include pain and suffering.
So, I mean, thank you for your questions. I will take them into consideration about this, as far as the charges go to the counties, about the number that Senator Randall Hoffer that you mentioned, and I'll have a conversation with you at a later time about that.
So this is one of the questions I have.
Yes, Senator Randall.
Thank you. This does not apply when there is no order protecting. So, in other words, if somebody is a victim of domestic violence with no order of protection, can that person recover pain and suffering?
I don't believe so.
No.
Because it has to fall into an exception of the general rule that there is no joint liability for non-economic damages. There is, for example, an exception where the case is based on an intentional tort, but only the intentional tortfeasors are responsible for the full damages, and people who are liable to negligence are not liable for the full non-economic. So, for example, we had previously passed in this committee the case of a landlord that doesn't provide the required security required under the law. Currently, they are not required to, even though it's an intentional tort, by the robber, they are not liable because they're only negligent. So in your example where there is no order of protection, there would be no non-economic liability.
So let me just ask this final question.
Yes, please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. There was actually a very high-profile case which just took place here in Baldwin County involving the Social Services Commissioner of Erie County, where the commissioner and a employee were here in Albany at a convention, and he was accused and just convicted of rape. So in that situation, where there is no order of protection, if the victim was to sue the county, she could not recover for pain and suffering. But if there had been an order of protection in place under this new law, then she could make a claim for that. Is that correct?
No, because I don't think that the circumstance you described would actually meet the threshold of liability. This is only once liability is established, and unless there the fact pattern indicates that they've met that very high threshold of liability, that would not be the case.
So the county would have to be held liable, which is a very high threshold.
Very high threshold, and we haven't changed the
We're not changing the standards of...
And municipal liability protection.
Thank you. Other questions? That's not my question. Okay, my question is, given the same, you know, liability being equal, is there a difference between a domestic violence victim where there is an order of protection and a domestic violence victim where there is no order of protection? Liability being the same in either case.
But under this, if this became law, then yes, there would be a difference where there is an order of protection in place. And I think, you know, when you're issuing an order of protection, that is the state making an affirmative action to protect this person. So therefore, there's a relationship there where there wouldn't be if there is no order of protection issue.
So right now, under the current law, domestic violence victims are treated the same. If we enact this law, then there would be two different classes of domestic violence victims and some can recover from pain and suffering if there's an order of protection, and some couldn't if there was no order of protection. Is that correct understanding or correct statement?
Yes, if you can find liability for the government in both cases.
Liability aside, right. Just based on change in the law, that would be the new standard.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Ransonhofer. Any closing comments, Senator Boone? Okay. And thank you for your offer to speak to our colleagues about any concerns they have. If there are no other questions or comments, is there a motion to move the bill?
Second.
Moved by Senator Savino. By the way, we've been joined by Senator Savino and seconded by Senator Sepulveda. What was that?
I said it would be tough to have Senator Savino move the bill if he was not joined by Senator.
Yes, I had not acknowledged her previous to her moving the bill. So it was an all-in-one statement on my part. All in favor of Senate Print 1868 by Senator Bailey, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay. Nay here.
Two nays.
I'm without rank, but I just want to make a couple of comments.
Please.
I think the bill is good, but as you can tell from my questions, I have some reservations about the different standards for different victims, and I would like to get that additional information, but I think the concepts good. So, look forward to having further discussion.
I'll be happy to have a conversation with you about any issues and reconciling the differences, because you do make an interesting about distinction of domestic violence. And what we don't want to do is say that your domestic violence is better or worse than somebody else's. So that's something that I'll certainly take a look at and have a conversation.
Great. Thank you,
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Thank Senator Bailey for this. We are concerned about domestic violence victims. We want to protect them. Just to answer a few questions before it gets to the floor, and then we'll have a different vote when we get there.
Sorry. You vote in the nay, not nay, without record. Okay. Okay. Two negatives, and Senator Ransonhofer without rec. The bill is reported to the floor. Next bill is Senate Print 2345 by Senator Kavanaugh.
An act to amend the general obligations law and the labor law in relation to the duties of skiers and snowboarders.
Are there any questions or comments on the bill?
I have significant concerns that have been raised by the Ski Areas of New York Association. There's absolutely no opposition by that organization or by myself to encourage the use of helmets by everybody skiing. I'm a skier, I wear a helmet. However, this bill is putting liability and fines upon the ski resort itself to check IDs of individuals getting on the lift to determine what their age is or not. I believe this should be a parental responsibility, and that is the basis there's another similar bill that Senator Little has, and I believe Assemblyman Jones have, and that's similar to a New Jersey law that's passed that does not put the liability on the ski resort. Further, and the difficulty of proofing kids getting on ski lifts when the line is moving and everybody's bundled up, and it's just not really going to be functional to do it that way. The Ski Association is totally fine with requirements of helmets being available for sale and for rent at these facilities. Also, they have a letter of opposition to this from one of only two ski area insurers in the country called Mountain Guard, and they insure over 80% of ski resorts in New York State. They are concerned about significant increases in liability insurance costs for the ski areas because of this. And I think it just goes too far in putting this onus on the ski resort rather than having it really be a parental responsibility that our New York State bicycle helmet laws require. So, I'll be voting no in this bill because of these concerns.
Thank you, Senator O'Meara. Just wanted to point out a couple of please. No. Senator Boyd.
I just want to echo Senator O'Meara's remarks. I too have heard from ski.
You've heard from the ski areas in your district.
New York State, very important. Not my district, but they're important for New York State. And obviously, many thousands of New Yorkers in enjoy it, but we want to do safely. The liability is a question. We're very concerned about potential huge increases in their premiums causing, and they're on the edge right now. It's a tough industry to work in, so we'd like to address some of those concerns before this building comes.
Okay, cool. I wanted to point out a couple of things. One, the violation would have to be a knowing violation on the part of the ski resort. They're not required by the bill to check IDs, correct? As I understand it, with Senator Little's bill, the onus is actually on local law enforcement, which arguably is an unfunded mandate, which I know is of concern to many members here. Any other comments or questions? Yes, Senator Savino.
I have a question. So I don't have the bill in front of me, so maybe you can walk me through. So the bill would require ski resorts to verify that skiers and snowboarders are wearing or have helmets. Is that what the bill says?
It would require the ski area operator to prohibit any skier or snowboarder under 18 who's not wearing a helmet from skiing or snowboarding.
And how would they do that?
When they check people in through the lifts, it does require a knowing violation. So it's to assess a penalty. So if someone is clearly under the age of 18, the ski area operator would be liable if they let that person on the ski lift without a helmet on. But presumably, if the ski patrol is on the mountain and they see somebody who's clearly underage that doesn't have a helmet on and doesn't stop that person from skiing, then they could be violation.
It also requires a notice be posted that states that New York law requires that all snowboarders and skiers under the age of 18 are required to wear protective headgear.
But that then shifts, I think as Senator O'Mara said, we're shifting the liability from the skier and the snowboarder that the law requires to wear the helmet to the operator as opposed to the person who's required to wear the helmet. And I have the same concerns. If the ski operator, are they supposed to look at the identification of everybody that comes there? I mean, what if you don't have any identification, if you're under 18, if you're a kid? And I hate inconsistency in the law. Right now, the city of New York has rolled out this expansive city bike program where we allow people to ride all over the city, where if you are riding your own bike and you're a child under the age of 18, you're required to wear a helmet. But if you rent one of these city bikes and nobody ever checks whether or not you're under the age of 18 when you rent a city bike, you don't have to wear a helmet. We are expanding Lyft and Bolt and all of these bikes to the outer boroughs. Nobody ever wears a helmet. And no one is suggesting that the liability be placed on Uber, which operates Bolt, or Lime, which operates the Lime bike. So I understand the intent behind the legislation, but I'm going to vote with that wreck and speak to Senator Kavanaugh. I think in an effort to comply with the concern of safety for skiers and snowboarders, it's important that we keep the liability where it belongs, on the skiers and the snowboarders, not on the industry, who would be almost impossible for them to enforce this. In a real profound way.
And if I could just...
Yes, please.
Sorry, it also does place that responsibility on the skier and snowboarder. It's on
that's where it was to begin with, and that's where it should remain.
Well, it's actually a new addition to the... There was no requirement for skiers under 18 to wear a helmet. This is adding a requirement on the skier's responsibility, and it's requiring both parties to be responsible.
Could you read that section 18, what is it?
Sure, so it's...
Dash 105.
If
he
could
wait 1 second.
If he refuses
to wear it?
I'm sorry?
What is the penalty for the skier or snowboarder if they refuse to wear the helmet?
It doesn't impose a penalty on them, but presumably the ski area operators have said that this is going to increase their liability, but really for liability purposes, we are putting the responsibility on both on the skier to wear the helmet.
But it's not equal liability because the penalty on the snowboarder or the skier would be, well, you can't ski today. But
correct.
The penalty against the ski resort operator or the snowboard operator would be financial in nature, wouldn't it? There would be a penalty of fine.
They could be assessed a civil penalty. It's $100 for the first violation or $200 for any other violation within a year. So that's a civil fine.
But it could open them up to litigation as well.
Well,
it has to be. Let's just be clear. It has to be a knowing violation.
Yeah.
The ski resort would have to know. That's different than your Lyft and city bike analogy, where, you know, Lyft cannot be said to know there are thousands of city bike users are wearing, are not wearing helmets.
Can I?
Yes.
We can live in reality, we can live in theory. The reality is that when you have provisions in law and case law that require entities to knowingly know something, the threshold is high. It's so high that it's almost impossible to win on that argument. But currently, if a person, let's say someone a minor, is in a ski resort, suffers a head injury, what do you have an analysis of the case law on whether these resorts can be sued anyway or have been sued?
We can look into that.
Right, because we may be just codifying something that's already in part of the case law. And it's, you know, the argument is just useless.
And I think the point here is, like, if I, the point here is to really assign responsibility to people who, and institutions and businesses who should know better. We're trying to protect young people from life-changing head injuries.
With all due respect to that, then we should do that with every entity. So I'm a skater. You're not required to wear a helmet when you skate. But Lord knows you're going to fall a lot and you're going to hurt yourself. But when you enter into a skating rink, whether it's a roller rink, when you're skating on a wood floor or a concrete floor, or you ice skate, you sign a waiver of liability and you accept the responsibility that if you fall, you may hurt yourself.
Those waivers aren't always effective.
True, but you Senator accept the responsibility for some of those activities.
I also worry when you begin to apportion liability. If someone has a serious injury, there's a deep pockets theory. Mm-hmm. You get into litigation, and who's going to end up paying?
But that's my point, though. I want to know what the case law is now.
Yeah.
If they're already getting sued, we're not really changing anything with this litigation, with this statute.
We're making it easier.
We're creating a new cause of action to bring
against
a new line of negligence by allowing them to ski without the helmet. It is very difficult to sue a ski resort for these injuries, and you've got to prove basically reckless. You've got to be out of bounds skiing. So it is a high burden, but this creates a new line of negligence against the ski resort.
With you were saying with anyone above the age of majority.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because a minor, I've never sued a ski resort, but I don't know what the law or the case law is pertaining to minors.
I don't know if there's a distinction.
Oh, I certainly will.
It's not Yankee Stadium where there's one entrance.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You have an open space, and you have people taking helmets off and putting them on. And if there's a serious injury, so there's a statute there. I know I'm going to go after this.
But they go off to you already. That's what I'm saying. I want to know what the success rate is. I mean, clearly we have to. I think we should.
Let me just say also. I think something that you may be, since you haven't read the bill, Senator Savino, or at least not recently, in section 115, there is a requirement. The burden of responsibility is on the skier as well. So that's, you are apportioning responsibility here, I think, to both ski resorts and skiers. That's very important to know.
I heard that, but the liability is not going to be the same. So I'm going to vote without Rick now. I think there's more work that needs to be done on this bill before it comes to the floor.
Okay, thank you.
I think this is a very healthy debate.
Thank you. I agree.
And I'm not
any further comments or questions?
No.
Senator Reisenhofer is voting in the affirmative.
No.
Just kidding. Yes, sir.
Was there any discussion, if you know, with ski resorts or ski slopes in the drafting of this?
We had heard from them several months ago, but we had not received anything back. And then they have sent us things, which we'll take into consideration, but after this.
Can you share what the ski resorts of this committee of what they have said, the information that you've gotten in, letters or documents or whatever?
I can take that back.
I have their memo of opposition, Senator. I can provide that to you.
Okay.
I would reference.
Senator O'Mara, do you have a comment?
Wait, I'm not finished.
Oh, okay. Please continue.
So back to the point that Senator was making about knowing, not knowing, should have known. So would it be, I'm not concerned about the liability portion of my question has nothing to do with liability. The question has to do with applying liability. So if there is a citation that violated a section of the law, is it an absolute offense for the ski resort to come in and say, I didn't know? I mean, if you say that, okay, or I thought they were 19, could a judge say, well, that's unreasonable? Maybe, you know, you should have looked at the person, or you should have done something else, checked ID. Is it an absolute offense to this section for someone to come in and say, I thought the person was over the age of 18, and then you can't be found guilty of violating this section?
My interpretation is that yes, it would be an absolute offense that you didn't know.
I don't think
the
Department
of Labor.
Senator Radnoff, no one's being found guilty.
No, I understand. Well, guilty of the infraction.
You're in the wrong committee for that. You're in the wrong committee for that.
No, I'm in the right committee. Obviously, you know, we're not talking about guilt or innocence, but
right.
We're talking about, you know, like with a traffic ticket.
Yes.
You know, it's not a criminal matter in this case, but still, this is a violation, just like it's a health code violation or a violation. So if you are found guilty under this section that you have done this, not if you're found guilty, but if you've been charged, you're saying that under this law, if someone comes in, whether it's believable or not, but if you say, I thought the person was over age, you will never have to pay any money.
Well, I think it's not believable that person, like if it's a 10-year-old and you say, I think this person was 23, then I think that might not be the case.
Well, but if the person is 14?
Then I think that it would be up to the fact finder here, the Department of Labor, to make that assessment of whether it was a credible denial of knowledge or not. And the Department of Labor is authorized to issue rules and regulations for all of these requirements that are in this bill. So I think that could go some way to clarifying some of these areas where it may not be clear the exact implementation of this, whether you're checking IDs or whether somebody takes their helmet off in the middle of the slope or something like that. The Department of Labor would be able to issue regulations on
Thank
that.
You. Any further comments or questions?
I have a couple of questions. So my understanding is a little different in terms of knowing, you know, this being an incredibly high standard. My experience has been, when you're charged, it's assumed that you knew, and the burden actually falls the other way to prove that you didn't know. So I view it, in my experience, as a very, very low burden, so that's a concern. But on the enforcement of this, is this supposed to be enforced at the lift, at the point of sale? And the second question I have right now, I just don't recall as I'm sitting here, is there a requirement to wear a helmet at a younger age right now under your scheme?
Not to my knowledge, no.
There's no requirement whatsoever at all right now.
Right, and actually, as much as like 10% of young children are not wearing helmets when they ski currently.
Percent?
I think that from the information that we got from the ski area operators, 15% of participants 17 and under do not use helmets, and 11% of children under the age of 9 do not use helmets. So just to give that scope, and I think there is a requirement that they post something at the point of sale. So I think that could be, if they don't make that posting, they could be found in violation there. And as I said to the Senator earlier, I think that wherever there is a ski area operator employee who knowingly sees a person skiing or about to ski without a helmet, then potentially they could be found liable under this.
So is this initially supposed to be enforced where buy your lift ticket, or you register, or you're getting like your lift? Where, you know, those enforcement points?
That's not spelled out in the law, Senator.
Right. It's not
spelled out in the bill.
But presumably the lift would make the most sense because everybody has to get on the lift to get on, and they're checking lift tickets at that point. If they're not checking lift tickets, then I don't know how they make sure that people pay to get on the.
So every time you get on the lift. Sorry? Every time you get on the lift, you have to take out your ID and show it?
No. You have to show your lift ticket, for sure.
Right. How about the age part? I mean, how does the helmet part work at that point when you're getting on the lift?
I think that would be up to the Department of Labor to
issue regulations. No, this was drafted by Senator Kavanaugh. Right. What was the thought process in terms of how is this enforced? I mean, is it the intention of the sponsor that when you get on the lift, you're supposed to, you know, undo your ski jacket and take out your ID to show your age? I mean, is that what's anticipated here?
No.
Well, I think it would.
No, that's not so. And by the way, in the little bill, the burden, and since Senator O'Meara mentioned it, is on local law enforcement. So this bill places it, I think, appropriately on both the skier and the ski resort.
Well, what's the intention at the lift? Is the intention that the skier is supposed to raise up their jacket and show the ID every time they get on a lift? If you're a teenager?
I think the intention is that it be decided at the point of sale.
Well, yeah. So the Department of Labor would figure out the best.
We've left it
flexible and allow the Department of Labor to figure out the best enforcement mechanism. For example, maybe the Department of Labor requires people to show ID at the point of sale when they buy the lift ticket, and then so the lift ticket might say, "I'm under 18" or "I'm an adult." Or maybe the Department of Labor could come up with some alternate enforcement mechanism, but we want to provide flexibility for them to figure that out through regulations rather than us having to put it in statute and then maybe some new technology comes along or something and we have to change the statute again.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments? I'd like to...
I've got one question.
Yes, please.
I have one question. That is, have we, other than the Ski Associations group, have we received any input on this from the state of New York for our state-owned facilities at Whiteface, Gore, and Bel Air, because this will shift liability to the state and those resorts?
Thank you, Senator Romero.
I would further, just one final note, a similar bill shifting the liability to the ski resorts was passed in California by the legislature and ultimately vetoed by their governor there. New Jersey has a law, as I said at the beginning, more akin to our bicycle helmet law in New York, where it's parental responsibility. I think this just goes too far in shifting the liability to ski resorts in this state.
Thank you. Thank you for a discussion that was very, I think, illuminating. Let me just add that according to the sponsor's memo, the Consumer Product Safety Commission estimates that there were 84,000 skiing injuries, including 17,000 head injuries treated in the U.S. in emergency rooms in 2010. The CPSC also estimated that 2,600 of the head injuries that occurred in children could have been prevented if they had been wearing a helmet. And wearing a helmet has greater benefits for children than adults. So I think the point is that there is an epidemic of head injuries because individuals, adult and children alike, are not wearing helmets, and we're trying to address that.
Mr. Chairman, the number that you just quoted, is that total head injuries for adults and children, or is that?
84,000 is total.
Okay.
And then 2,600 of those head injuries that occurred in children could have been prevented if they had been wearing a helmet.
Okay. So do we know on that number?
2,500 children.
So I was just told that Whiteface does require children under 12 to wear helmets already.
Yes. Chairman, is there a breakdown in that? Was it the 76,000 number? I didn't quite catch that. Between the breakdown between adults and children. I know it said that 2,600 of the children's injuries could have been prevented with a helmet, but it doesn't say of that total greater number, how many were children and how many were
does
adults?
Not. And not in the sponsors, no.
Okay,
thank you very much. Seeing no other further questions or comments, all in favor of, we need a motion to move Senator Kavanaugh's bill. Senator Bailey, is there a second?
Second.
Senator Thomas seconds. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
I'm aye without recommendations.
Without recommendations.
Okay.
Nay.
And a nay from Senator O'Meara. The bill is reported to the floor. Senate Print 3337A by Senator Gorin is next up.
An act to amend the civil practice law and rules in relation to the statute of limitations for public water suppliers and wholesale water suppliers to commence an action for injury to property.
Any discussion?
Just an explanation. What is the law right now and how does it change it?
So the law right now is that it's at the statute of limitations begins to run at the first detection of the contaminant, and it runs for 3 years. Unfortunately, in some cases, a public water supplier may detect a contaminant, but it's not at an actionable level yet, either because the threshold is higher or the threshold hasn't even been set yet, which is the case with a lot of new contaminants. So this would change it so that the statute of limitations does not begin to run until the last time that the contaminant is detected, so that if the, let's say the Department of Health had a threshold at 1,000 parts per million and now they lowered that to 500 parts per million, so the 750 that you detected is now actionable, that you would be able to bring that case even though you had detected the contaminant previously.
So does this change it from the beginning to the end?
Yes.
So this is kind of like medical malpractice theory where you have to treatment. Would that be what this is based off of?
I don't know that that's what this is based off of, but it's a similar, similar idea. Okay.
Thank you. Any further
questions? I have other questions, but
we appreciate the questions.
I'll save it for the floor.
Senator Sepulveda moves. Is there a second? Senator Thomas seconds it. All those in favor of Senate Print 3337A by Senator Gorin, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The bill is reported to the floor. Our final bill is Senate Print 3839 by Senator Hoylman.
An act to amend the real property law in relation to requiring the inclusion of instruction in ethical business practices and recent legal matters in the continuing education requirements for real estate licensees.
Thank you, Andy. Is there a second?
Any questions?
I love it.
If we can only make CLEs for us attorneys much more streamlined, it would be much nicer.
If our ethical practices imply...
This is the real estate industry.
All those in favor of all those in favor of Senate Print 3339, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The bill is reported to the floor. That concludes this meeting of the Senate Judiciary Committee. Thank you for coming. The meeting is adjourned.
Okay. Thank you, Brad.
Thank you.
It was.